A number of years ago, an author named Jim Collins wrote a book that has become somewhat legendary called Good to Great, to talk about businesses and how they can transform their company from merely a good company to a great company. And in that book, he told the story of Admiral Jim Stockdale, who was an admiral and became a prisoner of war during the Vietnam War. He was tortured multiple times by his captors, and yet endured, survived, and his perspective about who ended up succumbing to the effects of torture was interesting. Collins wrote it in the book and quoted him saying that the optimistic soldiers, those who started out with a high view of the likelihood of their early release, were the ones that ultimately did not survive. I've heard it said elsewhere that the pessimists went first, the optimists went soon after. Stockdale said this: they were the ones, he said of the optimists, who said, "We are going to be out by Christmas." And Christmas would come and Christmas would go. And then they'd say, "We're going to be out by Easter." And Easter would come and Easter would go. And then Thanksgiving. And then it would be Christmas again. And they died of a broken heart. What one writer says about Stockdale's situation, he says, what the optimists failed to do was confront the reality of their situation. They preferred the ostrich approach, sticking their heads in the sand and hoping for the difficulties to go away. That self-delusion might have made it easier, listen to this, might have made it easier on them in the short term, but when they were eventually forced to face reality, it had become too much and they couldn't handle it. Stockdale came up with a perspective, and Collins called this the Stockdale paradox, described it like this: you must retain faith that you will prevail in the end, regardless of the difficulties, and at the same time, you must confront the most brutal facts of your current reality, whatever they might be. You must retain faith, and yet you must confront the most brutal facts of your current reality. Well, Daniel 7, and really the last half of Daniel, helps us to do that. It helps us to maintain faith and a vision of God, a right view of God, and confidence in his ultimate victory, but also a realistic view of our experience or the experience of God's people until that victory is finally culminated. That's the point of Daniel 7. It's an antidote, as it were, to the poison of both doubting pessimism and unrealistic optimism that then leads eventually to doubt anyway. It's an antidote to both, and we need it. Daniel 7 is written in the Bible to accomplish this in us so that we preserve, so that we endure, so that we can see the final victory that God achieves. That's the point. Now, I have a personal goal as we go into the second half of Daniel. If you're familiar with your Bible and you heard that we're going through Daniel, I'm sure that at some point your eyes got a little wide and you wondered how in the world we're going to preach through this second half of the book, which is filled with strange images and stories and visions and pictures of monsters. How are we going to do that? Well, my goal is actually simple. It's not to answer every single question, but it is to attempt to make this second half of this book, as well as other apocalyptic, that's what they're called, types of genres in the Bible, more accessible. Something that could comfort you in your private Bible reading. That though you might not be able, as I can't, answer every single question about these chapters, they can be, so to speak, a part of your Bible. Something that you can read with benefit. That's the goal of going through these chapters. So I'm going to read the whole chapter. I'm going to do that swiftly so it doesn't take the whole message just reading. I'm going to do it swiftly, but I think we need to see the whole chapter and then we'll dive in and examine it. Let's read together. Daniel chapter 7, verse 1. In the first year of Belshazzar, king of Babylon, Daniel saw a dream and visions of his head as he lay in his bed. Then he wrote down the dream and told the sum of the matter. Daniel declared, "I saw in my vision by night, and behold, the four winds of heaven were stirring up the great sea. And four great beasts came up out of the sea, different from one another. The first was like a lion and had eagle's wings. And then as I looked, its wings were plucked off, and it was lifted up from the ground and made to stand on 2 feet like a man, and the mind of a man was given to it. Behold, another beast, a second one, like a bear. It was raised up on one side. It had three ribs in its mouth between its teeth, and it was told, arise and devour much flesh. After this I looked, and behold, another, like a leopard, with four wings of a bird on its back. And the beast had four heads, and dominion was given to it. And this I saw in the night, visions. And behold, a fourth beast, terrifying and dreadful and exceedingly strong. It had great iron teeth. It devoured and broke in pieces and stamped what was left with its feet. It was different from all the beasts that were before it, and it had 10 horns. And I considered the horns, and behold, there came up among them another horn, a little one, before which three of the first horns were plucked up by the roots. And behold, in this horn were eyes like the eyes of a man, and a mouth speaking great things. And as I looked, thrones were placed, and the Ancient of Days took his seat. His clothing was white as snow, and the hair of his head like pure wool. His throne was fiery flames, its wheels were burning fire. A stream of fire issued and came out from before him. 1,000 thousands served him, and 10,000 times 10,000 stood before him. The court sat in judgment, and the books were opened. I looked then because of the sound of the great words that the horn was speaking. And as I looked, the beast was killed and its body destroyed and given over to be burned with fire. And as for the rest of the beasts, their dominion was taken away, but their lives were prolonged for a season and a time. I saw in the night visions, and behold, with the clouds of heaven there came one like a son of man, and he came to the Ancient of Days and was presented before him, and to him was given dominion and glory and a kingdom that all peoples, nations, and languages should serve him. His dominion is an everlasting dominion which shall not pass away, and his kingdom one that shall not be destroyed. As for me, Daniel, my spirit within me was anxious. The visions of my head alarmed me. I approached one of those who stood there and asked him the truth concerning all this. So he told me and made known to me the interpretation of the things. These four great beasts are four kings who shall arise out of the earth. But the saints of the Most High shall receive the kingdom and possess the kingdom forever, forever and ever. Then I desired to know the truth about the fourth beast, which was different from all the rest, exceedingly terrifying, with its teeth of iron and claws of bronze, and which devoured and broke in pieces and stamped what was left with its feet, and about the 10 horns that were on its head, and the other horn that came up and before which three of them fell, the horn that had eyes and a mouth that spoke great things and that seemed greater than its companions. And as I looked, this horn made war with the saints and prevailed over them until the Ancient of Days came, and judgment was given for the saints of the Most High. And the time came when the saints possessed the kingdom. Thus he said, as for the fourth beast, there shall be a fourth kingdom on earth, which shall be different from all the kingdoms. And it shall devour the whole earth and trample it down and break it to pieces. And as for the 10 horns out of this kingdom, 10 kings shall rise, and another shall rise after them. He shall be different from the former ones. He shall put down 3 kings. He shall speak words against the Most High, and shall wear out the saints of the Most High, and shall think to change the times and the law, and they shall be given into his hand for a time, times, and half a time. But the court shall sit in judgment, and his dominion shall be taken away, to be consumed and destroyed to the end. And the kingdom and the dominion and the greatness of the kingdoms under the whole heaven shall be given to the people of the saints of the Most High. His kingdom shall be an everlasting kingdom, and all dominions shall serve and obey him. Here is the end of the matter. As for me, Daniel, my thoughts greatly alarmed me, and my color changed, but I kept the matter in my heart. When we read sections like this in the Bible, we can feel intimidated. We can feel lost. On the one hand, it's exciting stuff. On the other hand, we sense we're supposed to get something out of it, and we have no idea what that is. I don't think we need to be intimidated. I don't think we need to either overlook these sections in our Bible or ignore them. They have great benefit for us. This story is essentially broken up into, you could break it up into 3 sections. The first section describes these four beastly kingdoms. The second section we might describe as the description of an eternal king. And the final section might be a detailed look at the final battle. Okay? So I'm going to break it up into those sections. We'll walk through it, all right? So first, we're thinking of these sections as all accomplishing this goal of helping us to have realistic faith about the people of God in this earth. So what does it mean to hope in God in the face of the ferocious evil that is present in this earth? What does it mean to do that? How do you do that? How do you do that? Well, God provides Daniel some help and hope in that regard. And so we put it in these three sections. First of all, expect beastly kingdoms. All right, so that's point number one. Expect beastly kingdoms. You notice from verse 1 down to verse 9, there's this vision, this scene that Daniel describes. Now, this type of language is called apocalyptic literature. Apocalyptic just means revelation. It describes what happens a few times in the Bible. The book of Revelation is another example. And it's a type of writing. And the way it communicates is essentially, as I heard one pastor say, theology through picture. All right? Theology through picture. Now, we don't tend to have lots of this kind of writing today. And so we can sometimes be confused or lost in it. But it's something like poetic descriptions. It's not intending to be scientific descriptions that are literal physically in that sense. It's intending to describe the emotional or spiritual reality using what we might say as metaphor. So to use an example, we know we are somewhat familiar with this. Let's imagine you read a line in a poem that went like this. The sun was a castle guarding her from winter's siege. The sun was a castle guarding her from winter's siege. Now, we understand instinctively that the sun does not have turrets, it doesn't have a foundation, it doesn't have walls or rooms. We understand the way you feel about a castle is the way she felt about the sun in winter. In that same way, as she walked in the sun, it was like a castle around her, guarding her from the threat of winter. Now, winter is not an enemy army that comes with spears to kill and destroy you, but you can feel the emotional reality of that. In the way that an army might strike terror in your heart, so the winter's chill struck terror in hers. In the way that a castle might protect and guard you, so the sun protected and guarded her. Well, that's essentially the idea behind these images. We learn later in the chapter that these beasts represent kingdoms and kings. Now, we don't think that there actually literally is going to be a beast like a dragon. That's not the point, just like the sun is not a castle. The point is, the way you would feel about these kinds of beasts is the way you're going to feel about these kinds of kingdoms. The way you would experience fear and terror and trembling at these kinds of grotesque animal anomalies that came with a desire to devour and destroy and crush, that's the way you'll feel about these kind of kingdoms. That's the idea. It's to highlight and clarify the emotional experience that the people of God will have when they face evil empires. And he says this to Daniel to prepare him. A couple of things we can learn from this imagery. We learn we might be able, with the benefit of hindsight, to see how these were at least temporally fulfilled in certain kingdoms that followed Daniel. You notice, for example, that the lion that has eagle's wings that are plucked off and then made to stand like a man. That sounds a lot like the story of Nebuchadnezzar, the king of Babylon, who was humbled by God and taken down from his lofty position and then ultimately was restored and his sanity was restored to him. So with the benefit of hindsight, because Daniel's receiving this, in a time when he would have thought of Nebuchadnezzar too, we might be able to look back and say, that sounds a lot like Babylon. So Babylon is like a lion, and Nebuchadnezzar like a lion that was humbled. And if that's the case, we might be able to say that the next beast with the bear that has the ribs in its mouth, so it's devouring and then wants to devour more, that might be the Medo-Persian Empire. And then we look at the leopard that has four wings of a bird and its swiftness, and that is then divided. We might think of Alexander the Great and the Greek Empire and his swiftness of conquest, and the fact that his kingdom was then divided among his four generals. And we see this dragon that is exceedingly strong with iron teeth that stamps and crushes, and we might think of the Roman Empire. So it's not that we couldn't imagine. There's some historical fulfillment that we could even look back and say, boy, it sounds a lot like the empires that followed in succession. However, the Bible is inspired both in what it says and in what it chooses not to say. In the very next chapter, God is able to relate a vision with a specific empire by name. He says, those are the Greeks and those are the Persians. So this animal in this vision stands for the Greeks, this stands for the Persians. He's able to do that. And so in this chapter, he chooses not to precisely identify them. And I think what we're supposed to take from that is, in some measure, these kingdoms, they may have a kind of a temporal fulfillment, but in a broader sense, I think they describe the nature of evil kingdoms that exist indefinitely on the earth. That at some level we're fulfilled in each of these kingdoms, but, and especially that's true of the last kingdom that has all of these kings and seems to continue on and on and on with more and more kings following one after the other. In one sense, that's like Rome. In another sense, later in the chapter, it says that this kingdom, its destruction seems to take place when the final kingdom of God enters the earth. So there's a certain metaphorical nature to even the kingdoms themselves. Here's the point. The ordinary Christian can get the point of this passage even if they don't know every detail of ancient history. The ordinary Christian can get the point of this passage even if they can't go through and chart all of the details of history. Here's why. You can understand the nature of what he's describing emotionally. These beasts emerge from the sea. The sea would symbolize chaos and destruction for Daniel and the Old Testament Israelites. There's this sense of this danger emerging and coming up after them. The beings are all predatory. They feed on death. And certainly the death of God's people is in view here. They crush and destroy and devour. They're grotesque. They're not ordinary animals. They're lions with wings. And there's this misshapen bear, and it's already eating and feasting, and it's told to devour more flesh. So there's a sort of insatiable appetite that these animals have. They appear to be all-powerful and unstoppable, particularly that fourth kingdom. The horns would be an image of strength, just like an animal horn, of danger, of power. A kind of mighty, boastful kingdom. So the idea is, Daniel, there's going to be kingdoms, and they're going to be grotesque in your eyes in their evil. They're going to desire to destroy and devour. They're going to seem unstoppable, and they are going to succeed one after another on the earth. It's not going to be a short period of time of a brief kingdom. There's going to be kingdom after kingdom, and they're all going to have these qualities. And at some level, it almost appears they're going to get worse and worse, Daniel. Not better and better. Now, what do we do with this as Christians? Well, certainly at some level, those four empires that existed between Daniel and the coming of Jesus in a historical way fulfilled these. But we're told in the New Testament that these same kinds of traits will take place for Christians after Jesus comes as well. And so we can learn from this expectation because that same kind of experience is going to take place in the church today, even after Jesus comes. For example, Matthew 24, verse 9 through 14, Jesus says, "They will deliver you up to tribulation and put you to death, and you will be hated by all nations for my name's sake. And then many will fall away and betray one another and hate one another, and many false prophets will rise and lead many astray. And because lawlessness will be increased, the love of many will grow cold. But the one who endures to the end will be saved. And the gospel of the kingdom will be proclaimed throughout the whole world as a testimony to all nations, and then the end will come." Or we might think of Revelation chapter 12, when again, using imagery and pictures, We're told this: the dragon became furious with the woman and went off to make war on the rest of her offspring, on those who keep the commandments of God and hold to the testimony of Jesus. And he stood on the sand of the sea. And then we hear that other monsters come out of the sea to deceive and destroy God's people. So though there may be historical fulfillments literally after Daniel's time, on the other hand, this paints a picture of life in a fallen world for God's people in a way that we need to understand. Now, here's the point if we go back to the Stockdale paradox that I think is important. The church needs the expectation of difficulty and evil kingdoms so that when those evil kingdoms come, they're prepared to endure. If we never study and examine the biblical passages that describe this kind of terrifying, overwhelming, invincible, apparently evil, then when we face those kinds of enemies, we will be shocked and surprised. A church that never studies this kind of emotional, overwhelming picture will not be prepared when the reality strikes them. If we can't deal with the picture, we're not going to be prepared for the reality. It's a little bit like someone who was heading towards a part of the world where a known epidemic was ravaging the land, and they went in and just disparaged the need for any inoculation. That's what it would be like heading into our future without studying and examining passages like this in the Bible. Now, as I said, I think we don't like to study them because we feel like we're supposed to know exactly what this is referring to. Let me relieve you of that. I don't think we are. There may be some physical fulfillment. I think probably there is. I think it makes sense. But in another sense, I think God could have literally named the kingdoms if he wanted to. And so I think we can take the metaphorical impact of it as that kind of inoculation. Here's what it's going to feel like. It's hard to think about the story. It'll be harder to face in real life. Take the inoculation, study it, consider. This is what it feels like for our brothers and sisters around the world. They read this and say, that's exactly what it feels like. It feels like a dragon that is coming to consume you. It feels like a bear that's devouring and grotesque. That's what it feels like. It strikes me as interesting that Daniel received this vision long before he faced the lion's den. You notice at the beginning of this chapter, it says that he got this vision that when Belshazzar was still king. That's before Darius came to the throne. That's before the lion's den, number of years. And throughout this vision, we notice that Daniel's more anxious than we saw him in the lion's den. You may have noticed last week, Daniel faces those lions. He's calm. He's peaceful. We were talking in small group this week about that, and somebody pointed out, Daniel's peacefulness is just incredible. He's going into the lion's den, and he just seems totally calm. Well, I think we can learn something from the fact that God gave Daniel this vision before he faced that difficult test. When he got the vision, Daniel was frequently in this passage. He's anxious. He wants to know more. Tell me more about that really little horn. That seems terrible. He seems anxious. Even at the very end of the passage, he's still anxious. But somehow, over the years, God's word began to have an effect on him. He began to realize that, yes, there are going to be moments of intense trial and difficulty, but in the end, God will be victorious. Yes, you may have to face beasts, beast-like kings, but in the end, God will be victorious. And I almost imagine Daniel, when he gets the news, those who worship God will be cast into the lion's den, saying, just regular lions? No dragons? No flying leopards? Just regular lions? I've been studying this vision. All those beasts die in the end. They may devour me, but I won't be afraid of them. God only told me that would happen. We need that as well. We need that inoculation that comes from meditating like Admiral Stockdale did, staring directly at the face of what God's word says will be the case for his church. We need to stare that in the face, as it were, stare the dragon in the face and remember that in the end, the dragon will be defeated. The hope that we have in Jesus can sustain us through facing the ferocity of the enemies of God. But we need to remember that that ferocity will come. That God does not promise to remove us from all experiences of suffering and difficulty so that when it comes, we endure. So that when it comes, we're inoculated and we're not surprised. Expect the beastly kingdoms. If we have not experienced that to date, God be praised for restraining them. But at some point, and certainly our brothers and sisters are experiencing that around the world. So let's be prepared. Let's be inoculated. Let's study those beastly kingdoms so that we're prepared when we face them in real life. Expect the beastly kingdoms. First step in preparing us to have hope. Second step, see the eternal king. See the eternal king. You notice the change of pace and mood. It's almost like from chaos and destruction, verse 9 introduces this immediate calm and peace. Did you notice that in the passage? I mean, the horns are being plucked up and there's this grotesque image of a horn with eyes and he's boasting, speaking great things, and we know he's been devouring people, and then all of a sudden it says thrones were placed. It's just like such a transfer. Thrones were placed. It has the calm decorum almost of a coronation preparation where people are peacefully setting up thrones, and then it says the Ancient of Days takes his seat. The contrast with this Ancient of Days and the monsters is intentional. This Ancient of Days is eternal. His clothing is white, indicating his righteousness. His hair is white, indicating not fragile age, but wisdom and dignity and eternity. His throne has fiery flames, indicating his power of judgment. Fire issues forth from him, and his army is uncountable and invincible. That's the point of that description. And then we notice in verse 11, the ultimate end that this king will bring to his enemies. They are turned over. It says the beast was killed, its body destroyed with fire. So this seems to describe the ultimate day. I think that's the point of it saying other beasts, their lives were prolonged for a season. I think it's saying, look, beasts are going to come and go in terms of their temporal power, but there's going to come a day when that ultimate beast is going to finally and permanently be destroyed forever. And so this king will finally judge. We see the contrast. The first half of this section, talking about the beasts, is pointing them out from a human perspective. From a human perspective, they look like dragons and misshapen bears and flying leopards and devouring lions. But from God's perspective, in the end, they are only going to be fuel for his judgment. Important to see the difference. In the end, all of the beasts and the representation in earthly kings that hate God and hate God's people will finally be destroyed. And then he introduces the agent of that final victory in verse 13. I saw in the night visions, and with the clouds came one like a son of man. And he came to the Ancient of Days and was presented to him. And to him was given dominion and glory and a kingdom that all peoples, nations, and languages should serve him. His dominion is an everlasting dominion which shall not pass away, and his kingdom one that shall not be destroyed. One like a son of man. That means that what Daniel saw was somehow pictorially represented. Again, this is a picture. God doesn't actually have woolly hair, okay? This is a picture. It's designed to communicate the truth of something through a metaphor, through a picture, okay? So just like God doesn't have woolly hair, there isn't like a literal throne somewhere. God says, no. This is to help us understand what's going on theologically, truly. One like a son of man. One that looked to Daniel like a man. He had the appearance of a man. He was a human figure. And to Daniel's surprise, certainly as a faithful Israelite who believed in one God, this person is treated like divinity. He comes with the clouds of heaven. That was a divine prerogative to ride on the clouds of heaven. He's given dominion and glory and a kingdom, and all peoples serve him. The point is, this human figure is given divine power and worship. This human figure is presented as the agent or the representative of the Ancient of Days. This human figure rides on the clouds the way that God does. Daniel would say, I don't even understand how that's possible without being blasphemous. How could any man be equated with God? How could any man be given God's dominion? How could any man receive the worship and service of God's servants? How could any man be that way? And we come to the New Testament with our advanced perspective from the New Testament. We say, well, we know who that is, Daniel. That's God the Son, who became man. God, the Ancient of Days, God the Son, comes to earth, and he does take on the form of a man, and he is given dominion. He is given a kingdom, and his kingdom shall not be destroyed. Unlike all those other kingdoms, his kingdom shall not pass away. This king is our Lord, Jesus Christ. This king and his kingdom is the kingdom we enter when we believe in Jesus. This kingdom is the kingdom that Jesus said is now at hand, has arrived in me, is available in me. This kingdom that breaks into the world with the coming of Jesus and will finally culminate in the eradication of evil and the new heavens and the new earth. This is the new kingdom of Jesus Christ that breaks in to the kingdoms of this world. It's the kingdom that starts as a mustard seed, but then grows to fill the whole earth. And Daniel would have known this, but this kingdom comes in two stages. It comes first with the announcement of Jesus and his death on the cross and resurrection to ransom people for himself. And then it comes finally when he returns to gather his own and to destroy and judge those who have been his enemies. This is the kingdom of the Son of Man that was to be Daniel's hope when he faced experientially in his life the dragons and monsters of evil kingdoms in this world. And that's to be our hope as well. What does it mean to hope in the face of ferocious evil? It means that we see the King. We fix our eyes on the King, the eternal King, and the glory of his kingdom that is not entered by merit or by strength or by human ingenuity or wisdom, his kingdom that is entered by believing in Jesus as the crucified and risen Son of God. That's the kingdom that will conquer and will finally have dominion over all. That's the kingdom that will know no end. Consider the nature of this kingdom that we learn about from Colossians 1:14. It says, he has delivered us from the domain of darkness and transferred us to the kingdom of his beloved Son, in whom we have redemption, the forgiveness of sins. In Mark 10, one of Jesus' favorite ways to describe himself picks up the language of Daniel. Did you know that? One of Jesus' favorite ways to describe himself, it picks up the language of Daniel. Mark 10:45 says, even the Son of Man. That wasn't a phrase Jesus came up with or just thought would be a nice way to describe himself, kind of a grandiose expression. He's picking up the language of Daniel and he's applying it to himself. And he has a surprise. The Son of Man, surprise! Came not to be served, but to serve and to give his life as a ransom for many. That's the surprising thing about this kingdom and this king, and that's why we should fix our eyes on him. The Son of Man that is destined to be served by all came to serve all of his people. The Son of Man that is destined to have all dominion came to be despised and rejected so that people could enter that kingdom. The Son of Man that would ultimately be presented as the ruling governor of God's universe came to put himself under the judgment of those who had no right to judge him in the place of his people. Why does it have to be one like a Son of Man? Because if he hadn't come like a Son of Man, that kingdom would be full of angels and Trinity members and no one else. But because he came like a Son of Man, that kingdom is filled with people that were delivered from the domain of dragons and brought in to the kingdom of light. What do we do when we face, and you will feel at some point, I think in your life, or you'll know someone that will feel like they are facing a dragon? You say, I know the dragon slayer. Amen. Who was slain and in his death conquered the power of the dragon and guaranteed that all people washed in his blood would be a member of a kingdom that will not be destroyed. See the king. See the king. And we need to see the king. We need to see the king because honestly, we are a lot like Daniel. If you notice in this passage, after this, how many questions could Daniel have asked about the middle section, right? Verses 9 to 14. I mean, wouldn't that be, how is he going to be a son of man? How does this work? Isn't that blasphemy? I mean, boy, this is a glorious figure. Who is this? That should have been what Daniel was asking. But like many of us, and like me, he's fixated on details about the evil kingdoms. Did you notice that? I almost imagine Daniel's questions coming in a torrent and just revealing his heart, honestly, in many ways. After receiving the glorious vision of Jesus, he just starts barraging, apparently an angel or some kind of messenger, with questions. He wants to know. The visions, he says in verse 15, they alarmed me. And I approached one of those that stood there and asked them the truth concerning all this. And he told me, and you notice the simplicity of the initial response. It's like the angel saying, Daniel, here's all you need to know. There are four great beasts or four kings, but the saints of the Most High shall receive the kingdom and possess the kingdom forever and ever. You almost hear the angel saying, and isn't that great, Daniel? Because that's what his eyes should be fixed on. That's where his hope should be focused. But he's afraid, and he wants more details. It's not enough to know that they're coming. He wants to know how, when, what, where, why. So he starts asking questions. I desire to know the truth about the fourth beast. And it was really terrifying. And the teeth of iron and claws of bronze. And he broke and stamped what was left with his feet. And also about the 10 horns and the horn that came up. And then three of them fell. And the horn had eyes and a mouth. And it looked, and the horn was making war. I mean, you feel just the torrent. And it reminds me of me. Yeah, but what about this one? What's that horn? I need to know every detail. And graciously, God provides him some greater measure of description. But you notice, he doesn't give him lots more details. He elaborates a bit on what he said before, but essentially the message is the same. Prepare, examine, be inoculated about the evil. But you're not going to know every detail. You notice he doesn't give the name of those kings. He doesn't say what date they'll arrive on the scene. He doesn't say what the name of the empires will be. He doesn't say what the name of the generals will be. He doesn't say when the particular persecutions will take place. He just describes the nature of it. And I think it addresses our craving, like Daniel, to know more details. I need to know. And God says, you need to know me. You need to know the nature of the evil. Yes, you do need to know that. But ultimately, you need to know me. So he describes, and I would caption this fourth section, endure the final battle. Endure the final battle. So what do we do to have hope? We could summarize this whole chapter. We have hope, first of all, by expect the beastly kingdoms, by seeing the eternal king, and then finally enduring the final battle. That's one of the reasons I think this fourth beast that he says explicitly is not like all the others. It's one of the reasons I think that there's a sense in which it's not just some ordinary earthly kingdom. It has this sense of ongoing metaphorical value. It seems to keep going and going, and then its final destruction seems to be the time when the great judgment comes, and it says in verse 26, the court shall sit in judgment. That's one of the reasons I think this fourth kingdom describes sort of the nature of the end times with the great beast waging war on God's people, as it says in Revelation. And certainly the Rome represented that initially in their persecution of Christians, but I don't think Rome finalized the nature of that beast. I think it keeps going. You get the sense of what the end times will be like. And I don't mean end times as in a few years before Jesus comes. I mean the nature of the end times that we live in right now. And they may culminate and climax in a final ultimate battle, but I don't think that all this is describing only what happens then. I think it's describing the time of the end. Even as we hear in the New Testament, this is the end times. We're living when the time between when Jesus comes the first time, when he comes the second time. A famous commentator named George Ladd said that it's like the already and the not yet. Very helpful phrase to describe New Testament theology about the end times. Some of the things are already, like the coming of Jesus, but some of the things are not yet, like the final culmination and victory of the Lord. Some of the things are already, the king has come, but some of the things are not yet. We still await for the final vindication and judgment. I think that's a very helpful way of describing New Testament theology of the end times. The already and the not yet, both true. We are risen with Christ in God, yes, already, but our bodies are not yet resurrected in him, not yet. Already and not yet. And I think that describes this final battle. This is a depiction of what the serpent has been intending to do to the offspring and his followers from the beginning. There shall be a fourth kingdom on earth. It'll be different from all the other kingdoms. It shall devour the whole earth, trample it down, break it into pieces. 10 kingdoms shall arise, and there shall arise one after them. And he shall put down 3 kings. He shall speak words. I think that's a word of kind of blasphemous boasting. And he shall wear out the saints of the Most High. He shall think to change the times and the law. I think that's depicting a kind of a cultural power that he seems to have to dictate how things should be, how people should think. They shall be given into his hand for a time, times, and half a time. Again, God is able to give specific dates and numbers. I think that description, time, times, and half a time, means it's not going to be very brief, but it has a definite end. The court shall sit in judgment. His dominion shall be taken away to be consumed and destroyed to the end. So, do I think that there might be a literal physical kingdom and a literal person that ultimately fulfills this? Well, yeah, I think there possibly could be. New Testament might describe him as the Antichrist. But even as it says, the spirit of Antichrist is present already in the world. So could there be a final culminating governmental ruler that would seek in a particular way to destroy God's people and represent this little horn? Well, yeah, I think it could be. But regardless, I think this kind of experience is going to take place until Jesus returns. There's going to be people that speak boastful blasphemy against the Most High God. There's going to be people that wear out the saints of the Most High. There's going to be people that assume they can dictate and control how people should think. And they're going to appear to have literal power for an extended period of time. Yes, Daniel, that is going to happen. I'm not going to give you every detail about when or where or how. And even as Jesus said, you do not know the day or the hour. God knows what we need and he knows what we don't need. He's able to give details and he's able to withhold details, and we should be content with both. In this point, I think Daniel is to hear, yes, there is going to be times and sometimes intense times of struggle. You will feel worn out. It will seem as though they are invincible, as though they have control over culture itself. But Daniel, but verse 26, let me say it again, Daniel. How many times has this angel made this point? He made it back with the Ancient of Days. He made it after the Son of Man, that his kingdom shall not be destroyed. He makes it earlier when he says the judgment will be passed in verse 22. But then he says it again. But, Daniel, the court shall sit in judgment. His dominion shall be taken away, and the kingdom and the dominion and the greatness of the kingdoms under the whole heaven shall be given to the people of the saints of the Most High. His kingdom shall be an everlasting kingdom, and all dominions shall serve and obey him. And we read, even at the end, Daniel says, as for me, Daniel, my thoughts greatly alarmed me and my color changed, but I kept the matter in my heart. I kept the matter in my heart. This thought might greatly alarm you, that there could be a time of persecution for your church, for this church, for you, for God's people around the world. That might greatly alarm you. You're in good company. Daniel was greatly alarmed. When he first heard this, he was alarmed. He may have thought, well, look, haven't we suffered enough? And you may have heard or thought, well, surely if you just follow God, you'll have a nice, peaceful life. And now the Bible's coming along saying you might actually have to face some dragons. It's not peaceful at all. But be comforted. Because, you know, after a few years of Daniel meditating, and I think meditating on these verses, the court shall sit in judgment, his dominion shall be taken away, and that son of man shall rule forever, and his kingdom shall never end. Meditating on that, meditating on the end, he was able to say, when those messengers came and said, anyone who worships God will be thrown into a den of lions, he is able to say, I will go to my room, I will turn towards Jerusalem, and I will pray. And I will hope, and I will trust, and I will not be afraid. And if they eat me, they eat me. And if they don't, I'll declare to you, Darius, that my God is able to shut the lion's mouth, and also the dragon, and also the bear, and whoever we happen to face next year. How do you face the ferocious kingdoms of this world? But you face it with hope in Jesus Christ. Yes, there will be suffering. Let's be inoculated. Let's not be deceived. Let's not be surprised. But yes, we have a great Son of Man who has fixed a date when all suffering and persecution will end. Brothers and sisters, we need to encourage each other. This is a way to think about the small tests that we face. The little moments where your boss treats you poorly, or your family treats you poorly, or you struggle with equity in your neighborhood, or you don't seem to be treated rightly. Those are moments to think, you know what? This is an opportunity to trust in my God, because one day I could face kings that don't treat me fairly. I could face persecution that doesn't treat me fairly. I would encourage you, think of every test of inconvenience and unfairness as an opportunity to prepare for a much greater test. If you feel poorly treated by those around you, think of it as an opportunity to fix your gaze on the King who will render all unfairness eradicated from his kingdom. If you find yourself complaining about discomfort, think of it as an opportunity to fix your gaze on the King. Steadfastness in life is built by a thousand little moments of trusting God. Steadfastness in life is built by a thousand little moments of trusting God. I want to be angry right now, but I'm going to trust God. I want to be bitter right now, but I'm going to trust God. I want to complain right now, but I'm going to trust God, because the Son of Man will sit on that throne, and somehow by his grace, I will enter his kingdom. So on my very worst day, I have more to look forward to than any person who's never known Jesus. On my very worst day, I have more to look forward to than any person who's never known Jesus. On my worst day, I'm looking forward to that day when that Son of Man will be placed on his throne and judgment will be rendered and his people washed by his blood will enter into his eternal kingdom. In the face of ferocious evil, let's fix our hope on Jesus Christ. And in all the little moments in between, let's practice. Let's fix our hope on Jesus Christ. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, we exult in your glory, in your greatness, in your power, in your dominion that will never be taken away. And by faith, we believe that right now. We believe that your glory and dominion will never be taken away. And so, Lord, with gratefulness, we say we want to belong to your kingdom. We are grateful, Lord, those of us that believe in you, that we do. And we pray, Lord, that your invitation would go to all those who do not know you, that they would believe in you, they would confess your name, and they would enter into your kingdom now by faith and be preserved from that final judgment. We exalt in you as a church, and we glory in you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen.